Yes, thank you, Hasso, for the introduction. And yeah, good afternoon, everybody. I see my slides, but it's quite blurred. So I don't know if I can read my own text here. Let's see, it's very blurred. But I will try, and otherwise I think the best way is also to share my screen from here, but I will try. In the next 15 minutes, I want to review the JRC report, which was just introduced by the previous speaker, the LCA of alternative feedstock for plastic production. And I want to explain what the review is about. And then we did the review of this LCA methodology based on 10 aspects, and I listed them below. We looked at the aspect of carbon sequestration, maturity of production systems, requirements on data reporting, incorporation of land use change and indirect effects, requirements on providing proof, biodiversity, modeling end-of-life realities, normalization and weighing and sustainable feedstock sourcing. Number 8 and 9, I will not touch upon that because of time constraints, but you will see our views here in the full slide deck, which we will share, of course, later. Now, what is this review about? It is about the study introduced by the previous speaker. So that's an LCA methodology that has been developed to compare bio-based and fossil-based plastic products, so from an environmental point of view. And possible applications are, of course, policy development. It is also mentioned in European Commission's roadmap as evidence-based and data collection. But it will also be used by policy developers on national level, as well as LCA practitioners and consultants in general. Also mentioned by Simone, yes, we were given several opportunities to provide input in the last 3 years, and the industry experts, they invested significantly in collecting data and providing all kinds of feedback. And during that time frame, of course, the main question popped up, is this a good and a fair methodology to compare the environmental life cycles of bio-based with fossil-based products? And is it subsequently a good basis for policy development? And I will already give you the conclusion here to draw your attention. Now, a group of scientists of European Bioplastics have reviewed the LCA methodology based on the earlier mentioned 10 aspects. And the remaining part of the presentation will show that the methodology, in our opinion, is not sufficiently developed to deliver good, fair, and complete comparisons. So I will review now these 10 aspects. And the first aspect, and this is a little bit technical, apologize for that. It's about the characterization factors for biogenic carbon dioxide uptake and emissions. And in the methodology, they are set to zero in the impact assessment. And I think this is an old heritage from the biofuels industry, where one only has one end-of-life option, and that is incineration. So probably that's okay for biofuels, but for biomaterials, this is very questionable. Because for biofuels, you take carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere, you make your biofuel, you incinerate the biofuel, and all the carbon goes as carbon dioxide back into the atmosphere. But for biomaterials, of course, they can be incinerated, and then maybe this rule will be okay. But also, they can be recycled, composted, or landfilled. And then the carbon flows into other systems and can be stored there for a longer period of time. Then the second issue is about carbon storage. And the text says, effects associated with temporary and permanent carbon storage and or delayed carbon emissions shall not be considered in the calculations of the climate change impact. And I think here the value of bio-based products is denied. And basically, I think the starting point should be, and it's very simple, and should be every day, every week, every year, atmospheric carbon is stored in products. It cannot contribute to climate change. And that fact should be reflected in one or the other way in the methodology. So, conclusions, both rules deny the key advantage of bio-based products, and that is taking CO2 out of the atmosphere. Aspect number two is about the maturity of production systems. If you look at fossil-based plastic products, the production, conversion, logistics, end of life are optimized for the last 50 to 70 years. And we all know this is not the case for bio-based products because they are still in the early stage of development. And the question is now, does the methodology facilitate to make fair comparisons between mature and immature production systems? And if you read the study, it says particular care shall be taken. And of course, that is nice, but no guidance or rules how to compare are provided. And probably this will result in practice that all the products are just compared on being mature. Then the study even goes one step further by saying that the data of products based on innovative or emerging technologies cannot be communicated externally. And I was a little surprised by that, by using this LCA methodology. And I was a little surprised by that, because how can you inspire the market or all the other stakeholders if you are not allowed to communicate about improvements in your process or about new processes? So both are clear restrictions, and especially negative for bio-based materials. Then aspect three is about requirements on data reporting. And the first thing the study says, LCA studies typically look at normal production conditions. So excluding burdens and potential impacts from accidents, disasters, or conflicts, such as those from accidental oil spills and oil fires during extraction activities or from military operations. So this is a very old and still very beneficial rule if you are in the fossil polymers industry. My LCA background goes back to the early 90s, where the first time I got into contact with LCA. And this is a rule set up in the early 90s and is never revised. So that means that you do not have to report on things like emissions coming from burning platforms or burning oil tankers, leakage of pipelines or wars or fought around oil supply. So I think it would be good for all stakeholders involved that the JRC finally improves the methodology to include also these aspects in a consistent way. Then more examples on irregularities observed. For bio-based polymers, there were 8 pages with specific requirements. For fossil-based polymers, only 2. And of course, 8 versus 2 is very subjective comparison. But what you can conclude here that much more attention is being paid to the bio-based polymers to specify requirements. And I want to illustrate that with a few examples. For instance, company-specific data shall be used. That's fine with me. But the general requirement is not followed for the fossil-based polymers. Industry average data is still allowed. And we all know that it is highly aggregated data, often not clear what data exactly represents and what is included or excluded. You are looking in a black box. Third point, all data, all detailed inputs and emissions from agricultural systems shall be reported. And the people who know standardization, shall is really a very strong statement, shall be reported. But for fossil-based polymers, the text says relevant emissions directly to seawater, so coming from oil, metals or coatings, from oil exploration, drilling, extraction, and transport are frequently excluded. And a recent study from Youngblood says about fossil-based industry, unintentionally methane needs to be considered. And we all know that methane is a very strong greenhouse gas. carbon footprint of fossil-based products is underestimated and full emissions are not recorded. And I gave the link to the Jungblut study at the bottom, but in the final slide deck, I will also spend a specific slide on that. And then finally, on this slide, include specifics on machinery use in agriculture. That's fine with me. Include the machinery like tractors and combines. But if you compare that with fossil-based polymers, no requirements concerning including machine use, while for instance, oil from tar sand and oil fracking, these could be very, very significant. Then a few more heavy metal emissions in agricultural shall be modeled, fine with me, but no specific requirements for fossil-based polymers, while it is known that many fossil resources contain heavy metals. Chemicals like fertilizers and pesticides use and their emissions shall be modeled, but no specific requirements while chemicals are widely used in oil fracking and oil from tar sand industry. Then detailed requirements on crop type and country and region specific averages, fine with me. You have to know where your feedstock is coming from, but there are no hard requirements on the origin of fossil resources. And finally, about water, details on water consumption, including irrigation, shall be modeled, but no specific requirements on water consumption, e.g., for instance, about water injection in oil or gas fields. So, yeah, it is fine with by European bioplastics to include all these requirements for bio-based polymers, but then the same requirements shall be valid for fossil-based polymers as well, if we want to develop a clear level playing field. Then incorporation of land use. For bio-based polymers, the study is very clear, land use change burdens shall be included. Fine with me. For fossil-based polymers, it says land use change shall be accounted for, but these are typically not captured in LCA. And so again, there are also no hard requirements for fossil-related land use change. And so this means that there is no need to report on land use change impacts for oil from tar sands, oil pollution, long-term oil production, and oil fracking. And from this picture, it is very clear there is some land use change. So I think another, excuse me for the wording, pretty beneficial rule for fossil polymers. And also for land use change, the same requirements should be valid for bio-based and fossil-based products. And this is another gap in the methodology. Then let's say a few words about indirect effects. The study says one of the most commonly acknowledged indirect effects for bio-based plastic products is indirect land use change. Okay. But what happens in practice, indirect land use change is often just included or mentioned despite of the fact there is a lack of proof or despite the lack of commonly accepted methodology. Now, what does the LCA methodology says about indirect effects of fossil-based plastics? The study mentions a few examples like indirect effects by road construction and assessing oil fields, or indirect effects by military operations, et cetera, et cetera. And these contributions to climate change for each single effect can be up to 6%. So it is not negligible. And the study says indirect effects of those reported above shall not be included in LCA studies, nor from reporting of additional environmental information. So that's very interesting. Even if you have the data available, you are not allowed to put that in your LCA. So yeah, this is, I think, a clear biased approach. And again, in order to get a level playing field, these different approaches are obstacles to need and needs further improvement. A big challenge for current LCA methodologies are the direct and indirect effects of leakage of plastics into the environment. The study says impacts on biodiversity, landscape, toxicology are currently not captured. And these aspects should be reported as additional environmental information. But there is also a problem with that, because the effects of leakage into the environment is a big omission in LCA. And European Bioplastics therefore urges JRC to explore new methods to include these effects in the LCA. And just reporting as additional information is not sufficient to support decision-making activities, because impacts are just left outside the life cycle assessment, especially if you are going to work with single score outputs. If you work with single score outputs after a normalization and weighing step, then all this information is not taken into account. Aspect number six, requirements on providing proof. What I found on that is that for positive effects of bio-based products, such as soil carbon storage by improved agricultural management, and it can happen, for instance, by improved tillage practices or the use of cover crops, proof is required. And that is fine with me. But while for negative indirect effects of bio-based products, like indirect land use change, no proof is required if the indirect land use change actually takes place. Now, and in order to get a level playing field, also these kinds of different approaches need to be removed. And in practice, I think also for indirect land use change, proof should be provided before you can apply that. Biodiversity study says, currently there is no international consensus on the impact assessment method capturing biodiversity. And biodiversity indicators shall be included under additional environmental information. Okay. For bio-based products, the study also says the assessment should refer to materials that end up in the final product or have been used during the production, such as sugarcane, maize, or other crops used as a feedstock for bio-based plastics. So for the topic of biodiversity, there is a clear link between the production of bio-based plastics and biodiversity. Now, concerning fossil-based production, the effects on biodiversity for fossil-based plastics are only briefly mentioned in the methodology, and there is only one reference to biodiversity impacts due to crude oil drilling. But I think reality is slightly different, because we all know that the main reasons to the decrease of biodiversity are overpopulation, global warming, deforestation, and pollution. So global warming is one of the main reasons. And according to the latest IPCC report, global warming is largely driven by emissions from fossil resources and agriculture dominated by livestock. So there is a clear link between the decrease of biodiversity and the use of fossil-based polymers. And that is hardly addressed. So there is no clear link mentioned between the incineration of fossil-based plastics and biodiversity. And the effects on biodiversity is of key importance, but also leakage of plastics into the environment. It's another big omission in the life cycle assessments. So information is also here pushed in the category additional environmental information and left outside the LCA itself. And therefore, European Bioplastics urges also here JRC to explore new methods and to apply them consistently to bio-based as well as to fossil-based polymers. And then number 8 and 9, I skip. 8 was about the end of life, 9 about weighing and normalization. One thing I want to say about weighing factors, I saw that the used weighing factors were from 2018, and I think we should use weighing factors which are valid for the years to come. Because if you do a life cycle assessment, then it will be used for the years to come. And so it cannot be based from weighing factors from the past. Aspect number 10, sustainable feedstock sourcing. For people active in the bio-based arena, then they know that there are several certification schemes in use, like RSB, ISCC Plus, Bronze Sucro, They are developed and in use, and sometimes these systems are criticized. And I know maybe they are not perfect in all aspects, but I think they are a big step in the right direction. And they are dealing with a very wide range of topics like deforestation, biodiversity, protection of soil, carbon sequestration, but also safe working conditions, compliance with human labor and land rights. But we also have to note here that after these many years, there is still nothing in place for fossil-based feedstocks. And this aspect is then therefore also totally excluded from the methodology comparing and judging the life cycles of bio-based and fossil-based systems. And how can you do that? How can you make an objective and a complete comparison if you leave this out of the equation? So, conclusion here, sustainable feedstock sourcing needs to be included in LCA or at least attached to the LCA, especially in those comparisons where the major differences are coming from feedstocks themselves. And that's very important because if you compare, for instance, a polystyrene cup with a PLA cup, then the polymerization is the same. The conversion into the cup is the same. Logistics are the same. The use phase is the same. And the end of life is the same. The only difference between those products, and that is valid for cups, but also for bottles and rigid containers, the only difference are the feedstocks. And therefore, you cannot leave out sustainable feedstock sourcing. So, final slide, position of European bioplastics. Now, I think we all agree that a good LCA methodology is very relevant for the industry on the mid and long term. It is very relevant to extend a circular bio-based economy in Europe. And it is very relevant for the acceptance of our products by all our stakeholders. But the current methodology, we believe it is not suitable for making well-balanced and complete LCA comparisons between bio-based and fossil-based products. And I'm sorry to have to say that. I think it structurally tends to favor fossil-based plastics. And I try to illustrate that with the examples provided. And so undermines many of the deliverables set out by the European Green Deal. And therefore, we urge the JRC to stop the wider dissemination of this methodology and to start a new revision. So thank you for your attention. Of course, you can agree, disagree, suggestions, comments, questions, all are welcome. And please feel free to contact one of us. Thank you very much.